Assalamu alaikum. Today, inshallah, we start a new series called Why No Stories Equals No Quran. And inshallah, we're going to cover a lot of different topics that are new for this channel. We've mentioned them before in different ways, in different level of details. But inshallah, we're going to cover a lot more details in this series. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri. Wahlul uqdata min lisani. Yafqahu qawli. So this is part one of the series called Why No Stories Equal No Quran. In this part, inshallah, we're going to cover part of the story of Nuh, where it talks about his son from Surah Hud. We will get to that, inshallah, later in this segment. But we are going to focus on the importance of the Quranic stories to understanding the rest of the Quran. Toward the very end of this segment, we will include a very important conclusion that summarizes the history of what has taken place in the tradition of the Islamic Ummah. In part two of this series, inshallah, in a future segment coming soon, we're going to cover how to learn from Quranic stories. We're going to focus, inshallah, on two critical paragraphs and scenes from Surah Yusuf. And we're going to discuss in details how to extract specific semantic indications that are very reliable based on the details of such stories. So the subject will be how the Quranic Abrahamic Locution is anchored against anachronism and semantic slippage. And inshallah, in the future segment, we will define these very well and we will discuss why they are so important to understanding the Quran. In part three of this series, inshallah, we're going to cover what happens if you don't understand the Quranic stories. If you forego giving the importance and the relevance that is due to the Quranic stories. So we will conclude, inshallah, part three with the horrific implications of you and the Ummah not understanding the Quranic stories in the past. So we will start, inshallah, in this segment. We will continue discussion of the discourse on Zikr, which we started in a prior segment called Why No Mango and Pineapple in the Quran. In this segment right here, we have 12 new evidentiary signs, ayat, regarding the Abrahamic locution and its indication of Zikr. What does Zikr mean according to the Abrahamic locution, which is the divine lexicon that is used within the Quran? We will also proceed with 9 specific examples of methodological foundations that are related to the correct interpretation or the correct understanding of the word Zikr. Additionally, we will include a segment from Surah Hud, as I mentioned earlier, the story of Nuh's son specifically. And then finally, we will close with a very important conclusion. I hope that you stick with us all the way to the end of the segment. I promise you this is very, very relevant information. We assume, as usual, that you understand this is an academic presentation. This is not just for entertainment purposes. We make extensive use of the Quranic methodology, especially the concept of nested interpretation, as we have demonstrated again and again and again. The concept of Abrahamic locution has been described and detailed in so many other videos before on this channel. I invite you to go watch several of the videos. There's a complete playlist called Abrahamic Locution. And please go watch that one if you are interested in learning more about the details of this critical tool for understanding the Quran. And finally, please do not make comments and do not ask questions in the comment stream unless you have seen the full video. And if you find it useful, I encourage you to subscribe, click the red bell button, which is the notification button, and thank you very much for doing that. So a quick reminder about the concept of Zikr. We defined the term Zikr in the segment called Why No Mango and Pineapple in the Quran. The word Zikr in the Quran spelled this way, Zikr, represents the Quranic stories and parables. We've defined this in the past. We're going to give a lot more evidence right here very, very soon. So it represents what the Quran refers to as Al-Qasas wal-Amthal. So the additional evidence for the indication of Zikr is as follows. So we find in Surah Sad, which is Surah 38, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to Sad wal-Qur'ani dhi-dhikr, wal-Qur'an dhi-dhikr. By the Qur'an, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by the Qur'an. And if you remember, we said the Qur'an is the actual text, the actual scripture that we read and we look at when we have the book of the Qur'an open between our hands. That's the Qur'an. Dhikr literally means the remembrance. So it is referring to the Quran as having dhikr, that means it has stories and parables. And most of us have read in many, many different surahs, such as Surah Maryam, it always starts a scene or a new part of a story with the word dhikr. The very beginning of Surah Maryam, ayah number 2, right after Kaf Ha Ya Ain Sad, Dhikru Rahmati Rabbika. So it is definitely talking about the story of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon his servant or his wayfarer, Zakariya. And another scene that starts in ayah 16, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts that scene with Wadhkur fil kitabi Maryam, Wadhkur fil kitabi Ibrahim, Wadhkur fil kitabi Musa, and so on. So every time we see the word Wadhkur, it's the beginning of a part of a story that is part of dhikr. That's exactly what dhikr is. Dhikr is very, very clear. Again, we've given more information about dhikr in that video I mentioned, which is labeled Why No Mango or Pineapple in the Quran. But here we are providing additional evidence. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah 38, ayah 17, which is Surah Sad also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by saying, اصبر على ما يقولون. Be patient for what they say, and واذكر, and remember or recall or recite the story, واذكر, recite the story of our wayfarer عبدنا داود, داود ذا الأيدي إنه أواب, etc. واذكر إسماعيل واليسع وذا الكفل in Surah Sad, and so on. In Surah Al-Ahqaf, Surah 46, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَذْكُرْ أَخَا عَادٍ إِذْ أَنذَرَ قَوْمَهُ. So all of these mentions of the verb وَذْكُرْ exactly in this type of derivative morphological form, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us that this is related to dhikr. So we need to remember that at least 60% of the Quran is dhikr. In other words, at least 60% of the Quran are stories and parables, and we have to make sure that we give this part of the Quran its due importance, its due diligence. We have to spend enough time paying attention to the stories and the parables. As we shall see in a few minutes, the dhikr of the Quran, or the dhikr part of the Quran, is extremely important from a methodological point of view, and this is part of the subject that we are covering in this segment right now. So I want to say one more thing. The word dhikr has been taught to us as sitting and holding the tasbih, or just sitting remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and saying Allah, 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 Allah. And I'm not sure this aspect of dhikr is ever mentioned in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the word dhikr and the verb dhakara in very specific ways in the Quran. So we have to refer back to the Quran to understand the terminology of the Quran, and to practice the ibadat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us to do in the Quran. I'm not saying it should not be done. I'm just saying give it its due relative importance of reading the stories of the Quran within the Quran. So 60% of the Quran at least is dhikr, and therefore it is impacting a lot of the Quran. As we shall see, a lot of the semantics of most of the ayat of the Quran refers to the Abrahamic locution, in which the stories of the Quran are recounted. In other words, the compositional style of the Quran uses the Abrahamic locution, uses this divine lexicon. And if we don't understand the stories in the first place, for sure, we're not going to understand most of the rest of the Quran. I'm not saying every single ayah in the Quran contains Abrahamic locution. There are some simple ayahs that are very easy to understand. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. Very simple. It doesn't require a lot of locution. You just need some basic Arabic to understand it. But not every ayah in the Quran is that simple to understand. The majority of the ayat of the Quran require that you do your homework and refer back to the stories to really extract the divine lexicon, the Abrahamic locution, the locution that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught his messenger Ibrahim alayhi salam, and therefore gave us the chance to learn such lexicon through documenting it in the Quran. So now we go to 9 specific examples of methodological foundations related to the concept of dhikr as specified in the Quran. Number 1, we start from Surah Al-Anbiya. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. وَإِذَا رَآكَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِن يَتَّخِذُونَكَ إِلَّا هُزُوًا أَهَذَا الَّذِي يَذْكُرُ آلِهَتَكُمْ وَهُمْ بِذِكْرِ الرَّحْمَنِ هُمْ كَافِرُونَ. When those who reject see you, Muhammad, is addressing Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they treat you but with mockery, saying, is this the one who refers negatively to the ones you worship? Notice, يَذْكُرُ آلِهَتَكُمْ. آلِهَتَكُمْ has been translated very often as idols, but it's not necessarily the way it is indicated in the Quran. آلِهَ is anything you worship, anything you consider supreme in your own Weltanschauung. And we've talked about Weltanschauung in so many different other videos before. Please refer to the video that is titled, Does God Sit on a Throne? And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to Al-Arsh, He's referring to the Weltanschauung, to your worldview, to your intellectual foundation, to your intellectual constitution. That's Al-Arsh. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, anything that you hold supreme within your Weltanschauung, within your mental constitution, is considered aliha. You worship them. And the introduction of Surah Az-Zumar, Surah 39, defines this very clearly. I refer you back to that surah so that you can understand this concept. وَإِذَا رَآكَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِن يَتَّخِذُونَكَ إِلَّا هُزُوًا أَهَذَا الَّذِي يَذْكُرُ آلِهَتَكُمْ وَهُمْ بِذِكْرِ الرَّحْمَنِ هُمْ كَافِرُونَ. Is this the one who refers negatively to the ones you worship, while they themselves reject the correct understanding of dhikr al-Rahman, dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is defining rejectors, kafaru or kafirun, as a relationship to whether or not you truly grasp the understanding of the stories in the Quran. Dhikr al-Rahman. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is drawing our attention that if you don't understand the Quranic stories correctly and the parables, you may fit within this category. A'udhu billah. So we need to really reflect and take it very seriously. The fact that the verb kafaru, to reject, kuffar, is associated with rejecting dhikr, is very serious. And this is the first methodological foundation that we need to pay attention to in relationship to dhikr. Number 2, from Surah Al-Mujadala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, استحوذ عليهم الشيطان فأنساهم ذكر الله. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, Shaitan has taken possession of them. Of course, it's talking about Al-Kafirun, or those who reject. And then he made them forget the dhikr of Allah. Again, very important concept. Dhikr is not just stories. Dhikr is very foundational to how we engage the Quran and how we develop our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The opposite of a relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a situation or a status where shaitan has taken possession of that individual. Wal-iyadu billah. How does he do this? He made them forget the dhikr of Allah. Those are the party of shaitan. Ula'ika hizbu shaitan. Ala inna hizba shaitani humul khasirun. Unquestionably, the party of shaitan, they are the ones defined as losers. This is from Surah Al-Mujadala 58, ayah 19. Very well. number three in our examples of methodological foundations. And I really need you to pay attention to these foundations because they put things in perspective. They teach us how to give the right importance to different portions of the Quran or different parts of the Quran. This is from Surah Taha 20, Ayah 124. وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى. Whoever ignores my dhikr, then to him indeed is a constrained way of life. And on the day of resurrection, we bring him forth within a tight crowd, with a crowd, blind, he shall be blind. So I want you to imagine being brought out within this tough crowd on the day of judgment, and you have no way to see. And that's a result of depriving yourself of the benefit of learning dhikr, the stories and the parables of the Quran. Number four, in huwa illa dhikrun lil alamin. This is from Surah 81, Ayah 27, Surah At-Takwir. In huwa illa dhikrun lil alamin, liman sha'a minkum an yastaqim, wama tasha'una illa an yasha'a Allahu rabbul alamin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it is but dhikr for mankind. So it's referring to the whole Quran as if it is most important part is dhikr. For those of you who choose to seek the self-correction, and remember, we've talked about as-sirat al-mustaqim, the self-correcting way or the self-correcting methodology. That is the methodology that helps us correct ourselves. And we talked about this in part 4 of Surah Abasa. I urge you to go back and watch that whole series if you did not do so already. لِمَنْ شَاءَ مِنْكُمْ أَنْ يَسْتَقِيمُ. So you have to have the will to self-correct, to redress the errors and the mistakes that exist within your Weltanschauung. If you make that choice, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the promise in Ayah 29. وَمَا تَشَاءُونَ. As soon as you make that choice and you will with certainty, with sincerity, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately responds by Him willing that same thing for you. And as soon as you will the self-correction for yourself, Allah, the Lord of mankind, wills the same thing for you. This is the translation of this ayat. Here I put mankind in between double quotes because the word al-alamin has a lot more semantic nuances, and I'm not going to get into it in this segment because we're focused on the concept of dhikr and the importance of dhikr. But inshallah, in future segments, we will discuss this. We will discuss things like what's the difference between bashar, insan, nas, alamin, qawm, all of these different groups that are used within the Quran. Every single one of them has its own specificity within the semantics, within the divine lexicon that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala employs in the Quran. All right, number five in the list of examples. وَلَا تُطِعْ مَنْ أَغْفَلْنَا قَلْبَهُ عَنْ ذِكْرِنَا وَاتَّبَعَ هَوَاهُ وَكَانَ أَمْرُهُ فُرُطًا وَكَانَ أَمْرُهُ فُرُطًا. This is from Surah Al-Kahf, Ayah 28. It is addressing Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where it says, do not obey someone whose core, al-qalb, we've discussed this before, the core, the part that's hidden, the part that really animates everything about you without your sensing. Do not obey someone whose core we made neglectful of our dhikr. Again, this concept of remembering dhikr is so critical all throughout the Quran. And therefore, we have to constantly pay attention to the dhikr, which are the stories and the parables within the Quran. In contrast, someone who is neglectful of dhikr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him more of that neglect, gives him more of that forgetfulness of dhikr. Now watch what happens here. Someone who is neglectful of dhikr and he ends up following his own capricious opinion, and who is undertaking, meaning the way he engages interpreting the ayat, becomes based on disjointing the ayat, separating the ayat from one another. As we have seen when we discussed Surah Abasa, part 4, we talked about the concept of markings, which links every part of the Quran to every other part of the Quran, especially al-qasas, the stories. And we talked about every part of the Quran is really connected to the rest of the Quran. And this is extremely important concept to keep in mind. What is the glue that holds everything together? The semantic layer that presents the lexicon itself, that represents the concepts and the meanings of these markings, it is the stories. It is dhikr. It is the parables also. So it's very important not to be neglectful of the dhikr. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and by extension, all of us who are working on engaging the Quran, never obey someone who does not pay enough attention to dhikr, who does not use the lexicon that's presented within the dhikr in the way he or she interprets the Quran. Very, very important methodological instruction right here. Number 6 in the list of examples of methodological foundations. ذَلِكَ نَتْلُوهُ عَلَيْكَ مِنَ الْآيَاتِ وَالذِّكْرِ الْحَكِيمِ from Surah Al-Imran, number 58. That, of course, this was referring to the story of Zakariya and Maryam and Yahya and Isa and so on and so forth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing that part of Surah Al-Imran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is clearly defining them. Al-dhikr, al-dhikr, this is part of dhikr. And these are the signs we have just given you. And proceeds to define dhikr, or to attribute to dhikr, a new description, which is Al-Hakim. And we've talked about Al-Hakim. It doesn't mean the wise. Of course, stories are not wise. But stories provide hukum. And we defined hukum as the linguistic discernment. And this right here, we pick up a very beautiful jewel, very beautiful piece of information that is so relevant to the whole engagement of the Quran. The linguistic discernment is deposited within a dhikr, within the stories and the parables. It is the source of linguistic discernment. And that's why we keep saying, anytime you are stuck on understanding a word or a term or an expression, the first thing you should do is seek to find a context within some story somewhere where that term or that expression are used, and immediately you're going to discover the exact meaning. And as we will see very shortly, this is used for more than that. But this is very important benefit of referring to the zikr, to the stories. Of course, it goes without saying, you have to first understand the stories on the Quran's own terms. You cannot bring information from corrupted versions of earlier scriptures and impose them on the Quran and assume you understand these stories. Of course not. The Quran has its own versions of these stories, and therefore you have to strive, you have to work, you have to do internal jihad. وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا. Those who strive in our ways, in our definitions, in our lexicon, to extract it, to understand it, we shall guide them to our guidance. And therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is insisting that the reference and the authoritativeness cannot be brought from outside the Quran. In order for you to understand dhikr, you have to work within the confines of the Quran itself. You have to restrict your epistemology, your sources of information, to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us. Not bring from this side or that source, or this person said this, or that fake book said this, or that historian said this. None of those things matter. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us the story, you have to understand the stories in accordance to the lexicon that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used for those stories. So a quick example here, just to make sure, because we're talking about Hakim, the source of linguistic discernment. So when we open up a book of biology, it does not make sense at all to go bring a book of algebra and learn the symbols and the symbolism of that book of algebra and try to apply it to the book on biology. Every field has its own field of semantics, or what's called the semantic field. The semantic field for the Quranic stories is within the Quran itself. As a matter of fact, the semantic field for the whole Quran emanates from the Quranic stories, from dhikr. This is exactly what this ayah is saying. Very powerful ayah, even though it's really short. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and by extension us, that the stories are not to be trifled with. You have to start with the stories. Now, I will pause here very quickly and ask you, how many books of tafsir started by first understanding the stories and then proceeding to interpret the rest of the Quran? The answer, zero. None of them have paid attention to these methodological foundations that are attached to dhikr, to the stories and the parables. And this is a very significant black mark within our tradition. Number 7. وَاذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتْ وَقُلْ عَسَىٰ أَنْ يَهْدِيَنِ رَبِّي لِأَقْرَبَ مِنْ هَذَا رَشَدًا. Here, I'm sharing with you a huge secret. Huge secret. Those of you who are serious about engaging the Quran, those of you who are really serious about understanding the divine lexicon, the sentences, the ayat of the Quran, whenever you get stuck, and this is one of my secrets I'm sharing with you, whenever you get stuck, use this dua. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught this dua to our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whenever you forget or whenever you're stuck, say, عَسَىٰ أَنْ يَهْدِيَنِي رَبِّي لِأَقْرَبَ مِنْ هَذَا رَشَدًا. Memorize this dua. Make sure you use it every time you open the Quran. Make sure you use it every time you engage any part of the Quran, especially the stories. And recall the dhikr of your Lord if you ever forget. So what does that mean? وَاذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتْ. Of course it means, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. It means, you know, making dua to Allah. But it's more specific. It is not just a vanilla flavor type of remembrance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, recall the dhikr, meaning recall the semantics of these stories whenever you forget. So I'm forgetting what does furut or farrata or wama farratna fil kitabi min shay. I look up the word farrata or furut as in Surah Yusuf, and I understand exactly what farrata means. In the Arabic dictionaries, it means something totally different. In the Quranic lexicon, the divine lexicon, it means to separate, to split away, estrange. So this specific word, farata, which we saw a little earlier in one of the examples, is a part of the divine lexicon. It is not something you bring from the Arabic dictionary or the language of the 7th century Arab poets, as they did in the books of tafsir. You bring it from within the stories. So whenever you pick up such a story and you're stuck on any word, go back to the story that uses such a word. That's how you remember exactly what it means. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا فَرَّطْنَا فِي الْكِتَابِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ, and you already understand the word فَرَّطْنَا means to estrange or to separate or to disjoint or to break apart. We have not broken apart any part of the book. That means everything is interlinked. Now it makes sense. It does not mean the Quran includes something about rocket science or something about biology or something. Of course it does, but it doesn't mean it includes everything. It includes all the things within the Quran in an interconnected way. That's what that ayah is referring to. Number 8, وَكُلًّا نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ مِنْ أَنْبَاءِ الرُّسُلِ مَا نُثَبِّتُ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ وَجَاءَكَ فِي هَذِهِ الْحَقُّ وَمَوْعِظَةٌ وَذِكْرَى لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And everything in the form of stories that we recount upon you, it's addressing Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but again, by extension, all of us. But here I want you to pay attention to one specific word that we will come back to, عَلَيْكَ, عَلَيْكَ. And that's very important because this is what gave us the clue, the hint to interpret this ayah and translate it correctly. Everything in the form of stories that we recount. Now, I included this ayah, by the way, because it includes naqussu, which is qasas, which is the stories. So it's clearly related to what we're discussing. Everything in the form of stories that we recount upon you, of the dictates related to the stories of messengers, min amba'ir rusul. What is dictates? What is amba'? Amba' is not just news or information or reports. Amba' is something looking forward, something that helps you understand what's coming, something that helps you understand how to behave. That's amba'. So it's information that you can use going forward. That's different than an account. An account is just for information purposes. And that you put to use going forward. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam something very critical. Nobody has told you about this before. You have never heard this before. Qasas, the stories, are part of anba for you, alayka, upon you. This is required upon you. So we tell you these stories not just to tell you what happened in the past. It is not just for entertainment purposes. It is not just for making you feel better about the miserable treatment that you're receiving from the enemies of Islam. It's much more than that. These stories are helping you lay out your way forward in how you carry out your mission and how you deliver the message with which you have been tasked. This is a brand new piece of information. Nobody has told you about this before. Remember, we talked about the samawat being split from the scripture, from the text itself. One of the layers of samawat, one of the layers of understanding that are included in the Quran, is what is called the layer of wahi, the layer of enjoinment, the layer of instructions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives to our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and by extension to all of us. This is not just to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is also to us. When we understand these stories, they become something that is really critical for our training. And remember the guidance that comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the divine water that we talked about in the video called Why No Mangoes or Pineapple in the Quran. The divine water, which is the divine guidance, is commensurate with your own Weltanschauung. It's commensurate with your own level of understanding. And therefore, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes you understand a part of a story, it is helpful for your future. It is helpful for your planning. And we discussed in a prior episode the meaning of inna ma'al usri yusran. Whenever you run into difficulty, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you the understanding that this is an opportunity for you to run toward Allah, to run toward dhikr, and see what you can extract from dhikr. Forget about your troubles. Focus on what Allah can teach you on how to deal with your troubles. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repeated it twice, inna ma'al usri yusran, inna ma'al usri yusra. So therefore, the yusr, which is the ease of understanding that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will provide you specifically at the time of challenges through the stories, is exactly how we do this. And that's how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided his instructions and his guidance to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam during the worst type of tribulations that he went through. Everything in the form of stories that we recount upon you of the dictates related to the stories of messengers is also intended, and this is a beautiful part of this ayah, مَا نُثَبِّتُ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ, is also intended so that we steady your cognition. What does that mean? Steady your cognition. That means we make you remember the exact meanings of these words. By the way, cognition or fu'ad has been often translated as heart. So what is qalb? It's also heart. So there's a lot of confusion in the translation and the interpretation. This word is the same as that word, the same as that word. They believe in synonymy. The Quran does not have synonymy. So fu'ad and qalb are different words. They mean different things. So for example, in Surah Al-Qasas, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is discussing the story of Musa, the mother of Musa, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Qasas, وَأَصْبَحَ فُؤَادُ أُمِّ مُوسَى فَارِغًا إِن كَادَتْ لَتُبْدِي بِهِ لَوْلَا أَن رَبَطْنَا عَلَىٰ قَلْبِهَا. So in the first part of the ayah uses fu'ad, in the last part of the ayah uses qalb. Two different words meaning two different things. It could not be that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala meant for these two words to mean the same thing. And there's a new lesson for you, a new gift, so to speak. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using the word fu'ad in here. So what is fu'ad? Fu'ad is the awake part of your consciousness, of your cognition, of your perception. When you're awake, you are engaging your fu'ad. When you're not paying attention, what's your subconscious motivation is part of your qalb. That's the Weltanschauung that we talked about. So fu'ad is your awareness, your cognition, your intentional perception. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and by extension us, the stories help you align your fu'ad, your conscious cognition, to the divine lexicon through the stories. وَكُلًّا نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ مِنْ أَنْبَاءِ الرُّسُلِ. We recount upon you. You have to do what we teach you in these stories. Of the dictates related to the stories of messengers, so that we steady your cognition. In other words, if you follow the instructions we're giving you, and if you really learn and engage and strive to extract the Abrahamic locution, the divine lexicon, they stick in your perception. That's the reward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you. How do we know this? Allah is saying, مَا نُثَبِّتُ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ. We make it stick. We make it steady. We make it secure. It's rooted. It's grounded. It's firm. It's not going to be shaken. You trust Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you that confidence. And then the ayah continues, وَجَاءَكَ فِي هَذِهِ الْحَقُّ وَمَوْعِظَةٌ وَذِكْرَى لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And in this one, now, هَذِهِ, this one in the feminine form, we're not sure if it's related to the whole surah of Hud or this specific ayah. My inclination at this point, because I'm still doing the research, to be honest with you, is that this whole surah is full of such guidance and such firming up of the lexicon. And there is, by the way, if you accept the hadith and if you believe the hadith, there's a very famous hadith from our beloved sallallahu alaihi wasallam where he says, "Shayyabatni hudun wa akhawatuha." It drove me to have gray hair, the surah of Hud and the sisters, meaning the other stories of other prophets. And this is a clear indication of the importance of dhikr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this ayah, and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam translated that learning into that hadith. Perhaps, Allahu a'lam. But I tend to believe that hadith because it confirms everything in this specific ayah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala firmed up or secured his fu'ad, his consciousness, his cognition, his perception, wherewith he makes decisions and he understands things. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him in this one, in hadihi, this surah, al-haq, the truth, wa maw'idha, and an exhortation, and an example of the benefit to believers if those believers are allowed to spontaneously recall the divinely provided answer to their inquiries. Remember dhikra, we discussed this term in the series on Surah Abasa, part number 3, we discussed it in full details. It's really important that we take these terms and do the nested interpretation that we've been using all throughout the series and all throughout the videos on this channel. It is really important not to make things up from our own head, not to go to this person or that person, what do you think this word mean? No, do the nested interpretation within the Quran. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ اللَّهِ. Have the discipline and Allah will teach you. Remember, we said taqwa is the discipline in applying the methodology. Taqwa. Muttaqoon are those who show that discipline in applying the methodology. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us, you want to learn? Ittaqullah. So he says, wattaqullah wa yuallimukumullah. Have this discipline in your methodological engagement of the Quran, Allah will teach you. This is exactly what this ayah is saying. مَا نُثَبِّتُ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ وَجَاءَكَ فِي هَذِهِ الْحَقِّ. You have been given the truth, you have been given the exhortation, and you have been given an opportunity to spontaneously recall the divinely provided answers to all your questions. And this is exactly what I said earlier when I mentioned إِنَّمَا الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. Anytime you have challenges or difficulties and you have questions that you don't know how to get them answered, run toward dhikr. Run toward Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will open up the doors to help you understand. I'm not promising you it's going to be instantaneous. We talked about this before. It's not necessarily instantaneous, but it will come to you in a spontaneous fashion. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is promising that this is dhikra for mu'mineen. This is the definition of the word dhikra. Finally, we come to number 9, which is really a doozy, a very important part of this segment, and I hope you are still with us and paying attention. I really need you to focus because this ayah has been so misunderstood and so misinterpreted in the past that we need to spend a considerable amount of time. And after this ayah, we're going to get to the story, as I promised you, of the son of Nuh and see what we can extract from it. And I promise you, there are some beautiful, critical keys to understanding the whole Quran from that one, two ayah type of story. So example 9 of the methodological foundations, and this is the last example we have before we get into the story of the son of Nuh. From Surah An-Nahl, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ إِلَّا رِجَالًا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِمْ فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ وَالزُّبُرِ وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. So this is going to be a mouthful, and there are lots of concepts in here. And don't worry, I'm going to take it very easy, very slow, and we're going to dissect it in a very careful manner so that you don't leave this segment without fully understanding it. Again, this has been misunderstood and misinterpreted and abused by so many so-called scholars for their own benefit and for their own interest. And inshallah, you will see for yourself and you will judge. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, none did we commission before you. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ إِلَّا رِجَالًا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِمْ. Except humans to whom we instruct, we give wahi. Remember, wahi is the enjoinment, it's instructions. It is not just the method of revelation, as they taught us. It's not. In the Quran, in the Abrahamic Locution, it's the specific instructions. It's the actual content of the instructions, timely type of instructions, not all at once. So it is not the mechanism, it is the specific content of the divine guidance. That's wahi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues, ask in plural, fas'alu in plural, therefore those who are competent in dhikr, ahla dhikr. Now we understand ahla dhikr. It's those who are competent in interpreting and engaging and extracting the lexicon of the stories. Of course, because the lexicon of the whole Quran is founded in the stories and the parables. How else would you understand the Quran if you did not understand dhikr? So if you happen to be not an expert in the Quranic stories, you have not spent enough time, you have not put enough due diligence to understand these stories, you're allowed to ask someone who has done so. And hopefully this is what we're doing on this channel consistently for all of these videos that we have been releasing. Inshallah, we will continue to do so. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. That's not the priority. The priority is for you to do the work. If you don't know, then you're allowed, you're given permission to ask those who are considered experts in the Quranic stories. Again, which Quranic stories? Not the ones that are brought from the corrupted version of the Torah, not the ones that are brought from the Christians, not the ones that are based on the misinterpretation of the books of Tafseer who used the poetry of the Arabs. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about experts in extracting the meanings from within the Quran exclusively for these stories. Relying authoritatively on the Sultan, on the authoritativeness of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deposited in the Quran. Then you're allowed to ask such people. Which means, the first question you should ask these people, what is your methodology? If he tells you, I learned such and such book, or I rely on the opinion of this and that person who have been dead for 1200 years, then that's not a methodology. He does not know how to engage a dhikr. He does not, or she does not, know how to extract the divine lexicon from the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that are deposited within the Quran. So ahl al-dhikr, those who are truly competent in al-dhikr, dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So ask you, in plural, therefore, those who are competent in dhikr, if you do not have the evidence-based knowledge. Now, if you do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not giving you license to go ask this person or that person. Which means the priority is for you to understand dhikr on your own. To do the work, to do the search, to do the striving and the engaging of the Quran. The due diligence on the stories, first and foremost. And that's why I keep asking, how many books of tafsir really focused on the stories of the Quran first before they proceeded to interpret any of the ayat of halal and haram? before they proceeded to interpret any of the ayat that talk about salat. Most of you have been asking me about salat, or zakat, or hajj. Do you understand even the lexicon that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using for these ayat of salat and zakat and hajj? Most people are interpreting these ayat without having any clue what the stories of the Quran are talking about. So therefore, Ahl al-Dhikr are those who are competent in the stories and the parables. Once you are competent and you develop this confidence and this direct connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you yourself should have the confidence to understand the rest of the Quran. If you cannot, then this ayah gives you permission to go ask someone who is competent. So let's continue this paragraph. The next ayah, notice that there is a couple of words, there's a clause that really grammatically, semantically, syntactically continues the prior ayah. So bil bayinati wa zubur, and then there is a stop here. You stop, and that's well understood. Everybody agrees on this. And yet nobody understands why bil bayinati wa zubur is separated into a separate ayah as it is. So in instruments of deduction and concealment, remember we talked about this. Bayinat refers to instruments of extracting evidence, instruments of deduction, instruments of understanding how we find the ayat, how we decide this is correct, this is not correct. In other words, using the philosophical language, these are the instruments of epistemology. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to these instruments as bayinat. That's what bayinat means. And zubur refers to concealment. And you remember we talked about zabar al-bi'r ay ghattahu. The word used to cover up the well is zabara al-bi'r. And therefore, zubur is the concealment, the instruments of concealment. And yes, there is concealment in the Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about this in many different places. Not everything is readily accessible. And therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, every person who is a messenger that we've sent before you, we have given wahi to them, we have talked about Ahl al-Dhikr, and we talked about knowing with evidence. How do you achieve these three things? Bilbayinati wa zubur, using instruments of deduction and concealment. So let me take you to a chart, and then I'll come back to this ayah, because I promise you, we need to cover the rest of this ayah. But before we do this, I need to explain these two words right here. So I created a small chart to help you understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did with the splitting of these sentences over two ayat. So the first part, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِن قَبْلِكَ إِلَّا رِجَالًا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِمْ, it's translated right here. None did we commission before you, O Muhammad, but humans to whom we enjoin. That's the first part of this first ayah. Second part, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ, ask you in the plural, therefore those who are competent in dhikr. We described this. The third part, إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ, if you do not have the evidence-based knowledge. So these are the three sentences from the first ayah. All three sentences are applicable to the first two words in the next ayah. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala separated them. So this is one of the concealment mechanism. Look, he's talking about concealment instruments and instruments of deduction, and he's showing you right here. This is one of the instruments. This is one of the way I conceal, and I'm revealing it right in front of your eyes. Are you gonna pay attention? Are you gonna strive to understand? Are you gonna apply your intellectual prowess to see what's going on? So let's analyze it in a little bit more detail. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying the enjoinment that we've given to every messenger before you and you is using instruments of deduction and concealment. That means you have to learn what these bayinat are, and you have to learn what these concealments are. And just between parentheses, I have two full chapters in the book that I'm working on that include dozens of such instruments of deduction and dozens of these approaches and techniques for concealment. And inshallah, when we publish this book, you will get to learn all sorts of instruments of deduction and instruments of concealment. And this is not going to be easy. This is more for the specialists. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deposited examples of all such bayinat and all such ways of concealment. So therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying with the first part, the enjoinments to the messengers, even before you, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you, are camouflaged within concealment. And in order to extract them, you have to learn the instruments of deduction. I'll give you a quick example. When we talked about umniyatihi, and we said this is a concatenation of two words, and then we went to the other parts where we said yabna umma, two different words concatenated one time and kept split another time, Allah just taught you one of the bayinat. Concatenation is a legitimate way of deduction, is a legitimate way of extracting knowledge. And by the way, if you're not aware of it, it's a concealment. You don't know what umniyatihi is. You have a tendency to look it up in the dictionary of the Arab poets and say, oh, it's the wish, umniya. It's not. Umniyatihi is totally different. And unless you understand the instrument of deduction, you do not understand that it's actually the schema which makes up part of arsh, which is the Weltanschauung, and that's how you get to understand how to clean your schemas. So therefore, this is the first part. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying the enjoinments, the instructions to all the messengers and you are through these instruments of deductions and concealment. Second part, ask therefore those who are competent in dhikr. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not just leaving it vaguely defined. What is competency? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you the competency in dhikr means they know these instruments of deduction and they can smell when a concealment is there so that they can lift the cover and see beneath. This is exactly what this ayat, what this style of splitting bil bayinati wal zubur in the second ayah away from the first ayah is telling us. The third part, if you do not have the evidence-based knowledge, now it's very clear. If, on the other hand, you have taken the time to learn these instruments of deduction from the Quran and to extract all of these mechanisms and to see where there is concealment and not stop there at the superficial layer, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you that's how you become knowledgeable in the evidences of the Quran. So if you have that evidence, you can do your own interpretation and feel comfortable and feel confident that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving you the guidance. If you're not there, that's okay. Ask someone, but these are the conditions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you, don't just ask anyone. Don't just ask any person who says, Abdullah ibn Abbas said, or Sa'id ibn Jubair said, or Ikrimah said, or Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, or Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, or I don't care what the name is. If they don't give you the evidence in accordance with these instruments of deduction and concealment, then you should not accept their opinion, period. And that's why I enjoy when someone asks me, either using the email or using the comment stream, what is the evidence of this interpretation you're giving? Or how do we interpret this word? Or how do we extract this meaning from this story or this ayah or this clause? I enjoy it because that's part of the mission of this channel, to teach the instruments of deduction and the instruments of concealment. Of course, the whole thing will be published, inshallah, shortly, soon, in the book that we're working on. One last comment. It is very, very important to recognize that none of the Islamic institutions and the Islamic colleges and the Islamic universities and the ma'ahid and the madaris, all of those people who claim to be graduating scholars, none of them understand this ayah in the way I just described it to you. None of them is able to explain exactly what are the instruments of deduction and concealment that this ayah is referring to. Because they didn't even think that the Quran is giving us methodological instructions, as I'm just showing you. The Quran has its own methodology because the Quran is unlike anything else. It does not expect you to make up your own usul, your own principles and foundations and rules and regulations to interpret it. That's crazy. You should not do this. The Quran is unique. There is nothing like it. And therefore the methodology has to come from within it. So when you ask me, why don't you consult this scholar or that person or this preacher or this internet superstar? Because they have no clue about the methodology. They're making it up as they go, or they're relying on these old books that are 1,000 or 1,200 years old. There is no methodology in these books. They don't refer to the methodology of the Quran. How am I going to subject this divine knowledge to their approval? They don't know about it. They have no clue. This is like an example I just gave recently, and I apologize for using this language, but bear with me. Imagine you come to a medieval doctor and you tell him, I feel that I have symptoms of what's called now diabetes, right? They didn't use the word diabetes. They refer to it as sukkari, or the disease of excessive sugar in the blood. How did the doctor of those days know that you have diabetes? And I apologize, but please bear with me. In those days, they would take a sample of your urine and the doctor would have to taste it in order to decide if it's too sweet or not sweet enough. And that's how they would decide, sort of a random yes, no type of answer, based on how the tongue of the doctor is well trained to detect excessive sugar in the urine. Well, now we don't have to do this. We have methodologies, we have tools, we have instruments. I can tell you with accuracy exactly how much excess sugar you have in your blood. Now, that doctor of the medieval ages would never understand these new technologies. How would you want me to subject these new technologies to the approval of doctors who come from the knowledge level of the medieval ages? So I hope you understand why I feel so passionate that this divine knowledge has never been exposed before, and therefore no scholar can judge it. They have to first learn it before they decide how to contribute positively to it. So I hope this answers once and for all a lot of the questions I've been receiving about other scholars. So now we finished this part, we go back to the rest of the ayah as I promised you. وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. And we have made accessible to you the dhikr, remember the dhikr, the Quranic stories and the parables, so that you expose to people. Which people? People of prior scriptures. How do we know this? Because the next part explains it very clearly. What has been repeatedly made accessible to them before. Watch this Arabic difference between nuzzila ilayhim and anzalna ilayk. Two different verbs, or two different derivative forms of the verb nazala. Anzalna, one time we have revealed to you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we have made accessible to you. Before, the same stories had been repeatedly given to them, and they corrupted them, they forgot them, they modified them, they eliminated them, they added to them. And therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the Quran as a revealer. So it is revealing what they should have preserved. This is what nuzzila, multiple times, nuzzila ilayhim. It has nothing to do with those who say that this part of the ayah proves that the Prophet ﷺ explained the Quran. Has nothing to do with this, because the word tubayyin is simply to expose. To expose. Bayyana, to expose. Not to explain. So they're playing with the semantics, and they're corrupting the semantics of the Quran when they say that this part of the Quran proves that the explanation has to come from Prophet Muhammad ﷺ and the companions and the tabi'een. Bogus. Not acceptable. This is not what this ayah is saying. This ayah is simply saying to expose. In another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us very clearly, إِنَّ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ, this Quran, يَقُصُّ عَلَىٰ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ, reports in the form of stories to Bani Israel, أَكْثَرَ الَّذِي هُمْ فِيهِ يَخْتَلِفُونَ, the majority of what they used to debate and conflict about. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clarifies exactly what this means. Tubayyina, to expose, to bring forth, to eliminate their confusion. To tell them, we have told you, Allah told you several times before about these stories. And once and for all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is preserving them in the Quran. And this Quran, anzalna ilayka al-dhikr, these stories in this Quran, for you to expose to them, to show them, to bring out, to make manifest everything they used to receive or they received multiple times, but they lost or deformed or corrupted, etc. This is what this part of the ayah is talking about. And that's why I said these two ayats are so important to understand them correctly. Because if you understand them correctly, you will not be deluded by those who claim we have to have hadith, we have to have seerah, we have to have asbab al-nuzul, we have to have this, we have to listen to this person who died 1400 years ago or 1200 years ago or 1300 years ago. None of this from these ayat. These ayat are very clear. They're methodological ayat. They explain very clearly what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala included in the Quran in the form of bayinat and zubur. So I hope this is clear. Alhamdulillah, we move on to the final part of this segment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us proofs. So when I put number one in here, which is, none did we commission before you, O Muhammad, but humans to whom we enjoin, there is another verse, another ayah from the Quran that explains exactly why we're making this translation or this interpretation from Surah Al-Imran. فَإِن كَذَّبُوكَ فَقَدْ كُذِّبَ رُسُلٌ مِّن قَبْلِكَ جَاءُوا بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ وَالزُّبُرِ وَالْكِتَابِ الْمُنِيرِ. Exactly the same thing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, if they belie you, know, O Muhammad, that they belied also other messengers before you with the same thing, instruments of deduction and concealment. Instruments of deduction and concealment. Bayinat wa zubur. They belied them. In other words, they did not understand these techniques and these instruments. And therefore, they call you a liar. Exactly what they're doing to us on this channel. Exactly. They don't understand. بَلْ كَذَّبُوا بِمَا لَمْ يُحِيطُوا بِعِلْمِهِ وَلَمَّا يَأْتِهِمْ تَأْوِيلُهُ. They belie everything they don't comprehend, and their interpretation has not reached them because they don't invest the time to learn. They don't want to spend any comfortable time to really take the time to appreciate the new knowledge that's being exposed to them. This is exactly what this is saying. كَذَّبُوكَ فَقَدْ كُذِّبَ رُسُلٌ مِّن قَبْلِكَ. If they belie you, other messengers before you have been belied. Why? Because they're talking about bayinat, the instruments of deduction, that they're not familiar with. They're talking about zubur. Oh no, the Quran is very clear. They want to stay at the superficial layer. They don't want to dive below zubur, below the concealment that is there on purpose to deceive those who are lazy like themselves, to deceive those who are trying to bring foreign agendas into the Quran. They don't want to do this. They want to stay at the superficial layer. And therefore, you are the liar. Subhanallah. Wal kitab al munir. So this ayah is very clear that this is confirming exactly the translation and the interpretation that we provided for number one. All right. So number two. Ask, therefore, in plural, those who are competent in zikr. How do we learn about this? We learn it from the story of Nuh. Now we come to the story of the son of Nuh in Surah Hud, Surah 11. And there are two ayat, very simple two ayat, and we're gonna see how clarifying they are. And there is a lot of information in this ayat. So I need you to stay awake, stay attentive, bring a piece of paper to write some notes if you want, and inshallah ask me some questions via email if you have to. But inshallah we will clarify as much as possible in this video. Surah 11:45. وَنَادَى نُوحٌ رَبَّهُ فَقَالَ رَبِّ إِنَّ بْنِي مِنْ أَهْلِي. إِنَّ بْنِي مِنْ أَهْلِي. My son is among my family, my ahl. So Nuh called upon his Lord and he said, my Lord, Rabbi, إِنَّ بْنِي مِنْ أَهْلِي. My son is from my family, my ahl. وَإِنَّ وَعْدَكَ الْحَقِّ. And indeed your promise is true. Remember, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised Nuh that he will safekeep all of his ahl, all of his ahl. So Nuh is saying, look, my son is refusing to join us and you have promised me to safekeep all my ahl. So please help me safekeep my son. Very sincere, very innocent dua that Nuh is making. وَأَنْتَ أَحْكَمُ الْحَاكِمِينَ Pay attention to the words. And you are the best of all of those who provide linguistic discernment. Remember, hukum is linguistic discernment. Where do we get this? We get this from the story of Yusuf. إِنْ هِيَ إِلَّا أَسْمَاءٌ سَمَّيْتُمُوهَا أَنْتُمْ وَآبَاؤُكُمْ مَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهُ بِهَا مِنْ سُلْطَانٍ إِنِ الْحُكْمُ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ These labels that you worship, that you consider sacred, you are so attached to them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not put any authoritativeness in these labels, in these nouns, in these verbs, in these terms that you bring from the language of the Arab poets. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not put authoritativeness in that language. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put the authoritativeness in the divine lexicon inside the Quran. How do we know this? The continuation of that ayah from Surah Yusuf. إِنِ الْحُكْمُ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ The linguistic discernment belongs but to Allah, not to you. You don't get to make up your own dictionary and apply it over the Quran. وَأَنْتَ أَحْكَمُ الْحَاكِمِينَ Nuh is admitting that maybe he did not understand the lexicon. Maybe there are some terms that are yet for him not clear. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responded, قَالَ يَا نُوحُ Pay attention, please. This is so beautiful. قَالَ يَا نُوحُ He said, Allah replied, يَا نُوحُ إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ مِنْ أَهْلِكَ He, that son that you're referring to, is not from your ahl. So what is this supposed to mean? He's not part of his family? There is something going on. His wife did something. And that's not what it's talking about. Watch this. إِنَّهُ عَمَلٌ غَيْرُ صَالِحٌ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching him this way of working the verses or the lexicon or interpreting the terms in accordance with how you defined it, that's not the right way. إِنَّهُ عَمَلٌ غَيْرُ صَالِحٌ Remember we talked, عَمِلُ الصَّالِحَاتِ Work the terminology. صَالِح from مُصْطَلَح from the same gerund. It means the specific, precise definition of the term. So عَمِلُ الصَّالِحَاتِ Work the verses so that they extract the correct lexicon. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching Nuh, even during this time of trial, even this difficult time that Nuh is going through, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching him. Allah is blessing him with new knowledge that he did not have before. He's saying, إِنَّهُ لَيْسَ مِنْ أَهْلِكَ He is not part of your ahl. So the definition of ahl has nothing to do with family. Because Nuh is saying, he's my son. He's part of my family. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, ahl, according to our lexicon, is not family. Ahl, according to the lexicon of the Quran and the Nuh lexicon, which continued after him with Ibrahim, means the cohort of yours, or those who are similar competencies. Ahl. So in Arabic, even in common Arabic, we say, هو أهل لذلك. He is competent enough for this. So that's the definition of أهل. أهل refers to a specific level of competency to be part of a cohort. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is correcting Nuh. He is definitely not of your أهل, meaning a cohort of yours, a competent member of your group. Indeed, this is not a good way to toil on the divine lexicon or to use the divine lexicon. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching Nuh even at that moment. Remember, إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا The knowledge that comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is priceless, even in the worst of times. Even in the times when you feel you are under so much stress and duress. So this is the evidence for part two of the chart above. Right? Therefore, those who are competent in dhikr. أهل الذكر. This is what it means. This is what it's referring to. And the third part, if you do not have the evidence-based knowledge, this is referring to ilm, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ If you do not have the evidence-based knowledge. If we continue the same two ayat from Surah Hud that refer to the son of Nuh, we see exactly what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching us about the word ilm. So this is how we used it to create the interpretation for the above two ayat that we just saw above. فَلَا تَسْأَلْنِي This is continuation of the same ayah 46. فَلَا تَسْأَلْنِي مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٌ Please pay attention. This is so critical. Do not ask me not, of that which you know not with certainty. What is he talking about? He's not talking just about the usage of the word ahl. He's not just talking about the fact that Nuh applied the wrong linguistic definition to the term ahl. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying much more than this. لا تسألني, don't ask me, using the lexicon of which you have no direct evidence of knowledge of. Let me repeat it. This is so critical and so scary, so dangerous. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is teaching one of his closest messengers, Nuh alayhi salam, don't make dua using words that you have no certainty about. Let me repeat it because it's going to take a while to sink. Don't make dua. لا تسألني ما ليس لك به علم, that in which you have no specific certainty of knowledge. If you use the words that you make up to access Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with dua, or to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your supplication, you're making the same mistake that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is warning us not to do. لا تسألني ما ليس لك به علم. Don't make up your own language. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deposited the right language for making dua within the Quran. Dua, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam defined it, مُخُّ الْعِبَادَةِ, the essence of worship, the essence of devotional activities. And therefore, when you approach the Creator with a devotional act, you have to do it according to how He wants it, not accordance how you make it up, how you think of it, how you decide you want to speak to Him. Allah taught you how to speak to Him. لا تسألني ما ليس لك به علم. The continuation is even more scary. إني أعظك, I admonish you, I advise you, lest you be among the ignorant, al-jahilin. And now we have a new definition for the word jahilin. Jahilin is not just the ignorant ones, those who are illiterate, those who cannot read and write, those who don't read frequently, don't learn. No. The word jahilin, according to the divine lexicon, means something very specific. It means people who abuse the divine lexicon or don't even know about it. This is what this ayah is saying. Inni a'idhuka. Why? Why do I admonish you or advise you? An takuna min al-jahilin, lest you be among those defined by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as jahilin. This should send shivers down the spine of everybody watching this video. This is a very serious ayah, even though it's only two ayat from Surah Hud. And most interpreters pass by these ayat as if they're not so relevant. Watch how much we've extracted from them. This is part of the story of Nuh. So as you see, the stories are extremely important. And now we come to the important conclusion that I promised you at the very beginning of this segment. We need to step back and analyze what happened within our history, our Muslim history, the tradition of our so-called scholarship, the last 1400 years of great development of knowledge, of sciences within the Islamic history. Let's analyze it in light of everything we have learned so far. And then you will be the judge by yourself. So first, let's analyze what the Sharia Fuqaha did. The Fuqaha basically means scholars of jurisprudence. And all of you know what Sharia means. Sharia in their definition, by the way, not in the Quranic definition. In their definition, how they came up with that word and how they define it in the Islamic universities and Islamic colleges. They define it to mean jurisprudence, specifically halal and haram. But Sharia is much more generic than that for them. So Sharia includes all of the sciences that they teach in the Islamic colleges. The word Sharia in the Quran means something totally different, and we will talk about it some other day, inshallah. But we will use their terminology just because we're discussing the history. The scholars of jurisprudence, fuqaha, those who consider themselves experts in extracting understanding. That's what fuqh means, understanding. They focused on the 460 or so ayat that are considered related to halal and haram. By the way, if you ask any scholar of Sharia, you ask him, in how many ayat is there halal and haram? Immediately, the number is somewhere between 400 and 460, 465. It depends who you ask. But they predetermined that these are the only ayat they need to focus on. So everything related to halal and haram is limited to these 460 ayat. Out of how many? Out of 6,236 ayah in the Quran. So what happens to the rest of the Quran, my friend? I don't know. These are the ayat we focus on to extract halal and haram. Is that the only thing they worry about? No, they go to hadith. What else? Well, seerah. What else? The opinion of this person. What else? Let's agree. Let's make it up. Collectively. They call it ijma'. What else? Qiyas, this is like that. Okay, so I'll make up my mind and go with this. Well, what about the concept that Allah has determined what is halal and haram and we need to stop on that? No, we can make things up. We can add to that. The Quran is not sufficient. So they limited themselves to 460 ayat from the Quran. And then they went on and invented a whole made up pseudo-science called Usul al-Fuqh. What are the foundations of Usul al-Fuqh? Man-made. All based on human logic. Fully based on human logic. Some of them refer to some ayat or some hadith to buttress their argument. But the very enablement of Usul al-Fuqh is not from within the Quran. There is no such term of Usul al-Fuqh in the Quran. They made it up. This is a collection of rules and principles that they assembled, starting with Imam al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah, and they all follow the same thing, foundations of deduction from Quran and Hadith. What else? They came up with something called Asbabun Nuzul. Most of that field, by the way, occasions of revelation, is laden with disagreements. There is hardly any ayah where people fully agree on. And in the cases where they agree, it's even worse. Because where there is disagreement, there's room for wiggle. But when they all agree on some occasion of revelation, then they lock you into that interpretation, which is a disaster. Because that means the Quran was revealed because of those occasions for revelations. And it's insane. I don't know how they think about this. I really don't understand how they justify it to themselves. But it is to make themselves feel comfortable. Subhanallah. They also invented something called an-nasikh wal-mansukh, a whole pseudoscience they made up out of thin air, as we demonstrated when we talked about the video called Does God Sit on a Throne? And we talked about an-nasikh and al-mansukh, and we re-uploaded a whole small segment regarding an-nasikh wal-mansukh, the abrogators and the abrogated. What else? They invented a pseudoscience called Al-Muhkam Wal-Mutashabih. Based on what? Based on one ayah from Surah Al-Imran, ayah number 7. They read it the way they want, and they said, the Quran has part of it muhkam and part of it mutashabih. And they forgot that the Quran describes itself as a scripture that all of its ayat are muhkam. They dismissed that one. And they stuck to ayah number 7 from Surah Al-Imran. They interpreted the way they wanted it. Why? To give themselves some sort of distinction. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not say that the Quran is split into muhkam and mutashabih. Nowhere does it say that. I know they interpreted ayah number 7 from Surah Al-Imran that way. But that's not what it says. And inshallah, in a future segment, we will prove it. They also ended up disjointing the Quran. So when they took only 460 ayat and said, this is the summary of all halal and haram, they basically dismissed the rest of the Quran. They disjointed the Quran. And they violated a very important ayah that says, الَّذِينَ جَعَلُوا الْقُرْآنَ عِضِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is deriding those who disjointed the Quran into separate parts. That's exactly what they did. So they disjointed the Quran and established the most dangerous precedence that one ayah can be interpreted and understood by itself without reference to the rest of the whole Quran, without the reference to the divine lexicon that was deposited in Zikr. So who else do we have? So that's the first group, Sharia scholar or Sharia fuqaha. There's another group who label themselves as muhaddithun. Those are the scholars of hadith. And they focus on the narrations. Narrations through the chain of transmission that are reported to be sayings about Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I say this is pseudoscience because there is no way, if you apply any kind of historical criticism to this mechanism or this science, so-called science, you would be able to get away with it. It is all hearsay. And not only it's all hearsay, it's hearsay built on hearsay, built on hearsay, built on hearsay for five or six generations. Most of these generations, we don't even know if the people in the transmission chain actually existed. So there are lots of gaps and holes in those pseudosciences. They invented so many man-made pseudosciences to placate themselves. And then they claim that narrations may overrule and even abrogate ayat from the Quran. And then they distracted people from the Quran. They ask people to memorize hadith. They ask people to learn about all of the different ways of validating hadith, of learning what that Prophet ﷺ said in this case or that case, even though we have so many gaps and holes. Now, I'm not saying to throw away these books. Of course, they are useful for some purposes, but they don't override, they don't dominate over the Quran. They don't allow anyone the license to dismiss the Quran and take from them real knowledge. Real knowledge comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we explained. All right, so what happens? When they did this for the last 1400 years, let's be conservative, for the last 1200 years, the dhikr part of the Quran, which as we said at the very beginning, is more than 60% of the Quran, if you include all of the implications of the stories and the parables, that part of the Quran languished unattended. Nobody really spent a lot of time developing the knowledge and the sciences to be extracted from dhikr. So dhikr has been relegated to whom? To those who turned our Quran into mythology and children's stories, mostly for entertainment purposes, sometimes for morals, sometimes for learning what to say in this sermon or that sermon, to keep people interested, to put on the labels and titles of some video segments. But in general, they're not really of the essence. They're not really relevant to the extraction of real knowledge. Over 60% of the Quran falls in this category for them. So dhikr has been relegated to languish, unattended. Is that all? No, it's more than that. This left a wide open, huge backdoor for those who really wanted to validate their corrupted versions of the older scriptures, to come in and inject their knowledge, to come in and inject their opinions, to come in and inject their mythology into the interpretation of the Quran. Over 90% of the attacks against Islam and against the Quran are based on the wrong tafsirs that we inherited from the 1200 years of such tafsir. Where? In the stories. Nobody criticizes the ayah that says no compulsion in religion. They don't criticize that part. They criticize the ayah that talks about how Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam supposedly discussed with Zayd that he should divorce or keep his wife, and then afterwards Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam ended up divorcing that woman, and so on and so forth. They take that story, it's salacious, and they attack Islam and Muslims with it. They take the story of Abasa and Watawalla and they attack Islam and Muslims with it. They love the story of Tabbat Yada Abi Lahabin Watab. That's the Prophet's uncle. The Prophet's uncle himself refused to follow him. They love that story. And then they attack Islam using it, and so on and so forth. So what's the result? The result is that the Quran has been neglected for 14 centuries. This is what we're saying. You want proof? Just look around you. Are we the best community that was put forth for mankind? And if the answer is no, clearly no, you have to ask why. Why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala leaving us that way? The answer is because we left his book. He gave us the best gift to mankind. and we chopped it up. We created pseudosciences. We invented our own way to extract knowledge from other sources. We relied on what the Quran told us are corrupted sources. And that's how we ended up where we are. So I ask you to support this channel, because we're doing everything we can to fix this problem. And if you don't understand that we have a problem, then we really don't think this channel is for you. If you truly understand that we have a problem, and we've had a problem for a long time, then we are working to fix it, to create a solution using the new methodology that we keep talking about, the Quranic methodology. This is not my methodology. This is extracted from the Quran, as I just showed you. Everything we can extract from the Quran if we pay attention and open our eyes. If we learn the stories according to the Quran. And we are offering solution for a new generation of Muslims who love the Quran, and they want a reason to grab on to the truthfulness of the Quran, to discover the gems and the jewels, and to walk through Jannat that are promised to us by the Quran. I ask you to subscribe, click the red bell button, like and share and comment in a polite manner with open-ended questions where really honestly you seek to learn. And inshallah, you will be joining us for the long haul, where we succeed inshallah in achieving our mission. And we come to the closure where we make the dua. Alhamdulillah alladhi hadana li hadha wa ma kunna linahtadiya lawla an hadana Allah laqad ja'at rusulu rabbina bil haqq. I thank you very much for watching. Salamun alaykum.